yesterday. So even with the halved points, he maintains a 46-point advantage over South African Philip Atkinson, who is level with Freddie Penn, the winner of the opening two races in the Brands Hatch Indy Circuit, and 5 points ahead of the third-place man yesterday, Alex Alicia of Spain, who is just ahead of the man who starts on pole position, and that's Charlie King. Just turned 17 on the 2nd of August. Charlie, the young man from Galston, just outside Great Yarmouth, on the Pressure Integrity Racing team. He starts from pole position after that fastest lap yesterday. Stratstone Racing's Chrissy Rouse, the championship leader, is second. Tom Ward Racing's Tom Ward is third on the grid. Second row headed by M40 Triumph Dales Racing's Freddie Pett, from BCN Racing's Alex Alicia, and Qingdao WK Bikes Pure Triumph Philip. P Racing Scott Pitchers, and on the fourth row of the grid, Littlewood Racing's Dan Hellyer, ahead of Jesse James Jones Racing's Jesse Jones. And then the Motorcycle Sport and Leisure magazine backed Ben Miller, number 78. On the grid then, look at there from the just turned 17-year-old, number 76, Charlie King. Can he get the start he wants? It didn't look like he got such a good drive initially, and Chrissy Rouse might emerge at the front on the pale blue Stratstone Racing bike, but he doesn't. One of the white bikes launches through, I think, from the second row of the grid, and that might have been number 91, the Spaniard, Alex Alicia, who made the start. I think it is. Alicia it on the BCN Racing bike ahead of Chrissy Rouse, and then that bright yellow Pressure Integrity Racing Triumph Daytona of Charlie King. So leading into Park Corner at the moment, Chrissy Rouse, that distinctive sky blue machine, very appropriate beneath an absolutely cloudless sky here in the Lincolnshire Wolds today, and he's running in. Look at that huge crew of riders, 33 of them pouring through Charlie's. And down the hill, the lead has been taken now by Chrissy Rouse. And look at the pressure being put on by Charlie King. He's looking for that second place, the tall East Anglian from Great Yarmouth.
Ooh, not so easy on the first lap to get 35 riders through that little chicane, I've got to say.
And Chrissy Rouse looking flying, thoroughly determined already as the Geordie student, A-level student, launches across the mountaintop. He leads the way through Hall Bends. And a good start also for Philip Atkinson, a veteran of this class. They're running there, I think, in third place. Oh, look at this, steady on, boys. Charlie King went very deep in at the end,
yeah,
and it cost him.
Well. Yep.
Briefly of Charlie King, who swoops back around the outside, and then Ward gets mugged as he goes into the uphill left-hander by Freddie Pett.
And then gets back in front of Freddie Pett. All change here in this Triumph Triple Challenge.
Hellyer, Jones, Tom Oliver, Luke Shelley, Scott Pitchers, Ben Miller are the top 12 ahead of Tarrant Skinner, Middlemass and Cox, and rounding out that top 15. But at the front at the moment, a handy advantage for Chrissy Rouse, where the man in second place will be looking to try and run him down. I beg your pardon, the man in third place, Charlie King. There he is. He's got Alicia ahead of him and Chrissy Rouse in the lead. So quite a lot of work for Charlie King to do.
Pett and Atkinson still at each other's throats. Going at the end of the straight there, swapping places.
As they go through Mansfield and into the chicane, the battle closing up now for the podium spots, because number 91, Alex Alicia, finds himself under a little bit of pressure now from the aggressive number 76, Charlie King. Oh, King is very conservative. I say he's aggressive, and then he just sits her down over the mountaintop, Jay.
Yeah, and the funny thing is about King, he's actually, Charlie King, the yellow bike there, number 76, he's actually the least aggressive person in the world when you meet him in the paddock. And it always amazes me that sometimes that's the case. You know, you get these meek and mild and kind of very polite lads that won't say boo to a goose in the paddock. They get on the bike and they turn into a different person altogether when the visor's down.
Charlie King there then running in third place behind Chrissy Rouse and Alicia, with Tom Ward, Freddie Pett, Philip Atkinson, Dan Hellyer all lining up behind him, trying to get in the push for a rostrum finish. And they've closed the gap slightly. Fastest man on that lap, 133.329. It's nothing like the speed of yesterday. I don't know whether the extra heat has anything to do with that, but Charlie King set a new lap record yesterday of 1 minute 32.977, the only man who's ever got the, one of the Triumph round here at under 1 minute 33. He's not going quite that pace because Chrissy Rouse at the front with the one
directly on the track that warms it up. If there's a little bit of cloud at all, even if the ambient temperature isn't much different, the track temperature depends more on sunlight than it does on actual ambient temperature of the day.
Well, we've certainly got plenty of sunshine.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Step out there now and it's
beautiful.
It's kind of it's that sort of stuff that instantly make you feel the burn on your skin when you get out under it. I reckon there'll be a fair few pink people around there out there by the time today is ended. And now right on the back wheel, Spaniard is Charlie King and Tom Ward and Freddie Pett, not to mention Philip Atkinson on that distinctive South African helmet, or rather underneath that distinctive South African helmet. And Dan Hellyer running behind them, of course, has also enjoyed some success during the course of this championship. He had three successive second places, two at Snetterton, one at the Brands Hatch Grand Prix circuit. So Rouse, Alicia, King, Ward, Pett, Atkinson are the top six. They've broken clear a bit of Jesse James, Jones, Dan Hellyer and Tom Oliver.
Watch out for Charlie King. He did have a little bit of a think about it. He came from way back into Park Corner, looking up the inside of Alester.
Just checking about the back down.
Oh, big crash, sorry, Jack. Riders clicked just going into Chris's curve. I'm sure he clipped them.
That's not Atkinson. I don't know who's gone down there. It might be, is it Pett? Anyway. And it's Dan Hellyer who's gone down. Oh, commentators, curse, Dan. I just told you how well you've been doing by claiming three successive second places.
Pushing really hard. I think he clipped the back of Jones. You just watch this. Watch the back of the shot, look.
He got taken out, really. Plumbing proper. I think that was that Tom Oliver, number two, who came right up underneath him there.
He'd been
just
done by
both. Swiped him.
Yeah, it was Hellyer and Oliver that kind of had a go at him there. He just got, completely shoved wide. That's not a good place to do it either. It's only when you hit the floor there that you realise how fast you're going. That'd be probably about a 90 mile an hour get off.
So Chrissy Rouse is still in the lead. Alicia has responded to Charlie King's pressure and opened up a bit of a gap. Then we've got Ward, Pett, Atkinson, Jones and Oliver, the men who combined to see off the luckless Dan Hellyer. That's number 37, Jesse James Jones from Basildon. So they certainly did gang up on the unfortunate Dan Hellyer then. Chrissy Rouse still looking, comfortable at the front. He's running the same pace as the guys behind
him. Charlie King.
That was a long run, a long drive in from Charlie King. He leads the door.
You know, I said he came from way back into Park the lap before, and he's very strong. Ooh, that's a good move there up the inside of Chris's. It's going to push him wide of the goosenecks. That should work, though.
Charlie King then dropping downhill. Move from the young fella from just outside Great Yarmouth. He now grabs back the advantage in second place. Good. But look at this pressure now from the white motorcycle of Alex Alicia from Tom Ward, number 121.
Yeah, a couple of really unusual moves there from Charlie King to get past Alicia. Odd places, but I think he was getting a little bit frustrated. But he's really strong into Park at the end of the straight. He passed a bike to get him level and then just nipping past on the brakes. He was coming from a long way back.
So Charlie King now leads this group of five in the chase of number 55, Chrissy Rouse.
Well,
and now Philip Atkinson makes progress. He's got the better of, is that Freddie Pett with the, or is it Ward with the, it's Ward with the bright orange helmet. So here comes Alex Alosha, the lighter, smaller man, makes a move up the inside, but doesn't quite work. And a problem there, he had been shedding places and suddenly there is a problem for Tom Ward, number 121. And he moves offline and puts up his arm to let the opposition know that they're summing up with his motorcycle. That's number 121, Tom Ward, on the Tom Ward Racing Tri from Canterbury in Kent.
Yeah, did the right thing getting off track. You don't know, that's a mechanical that's fairly, I would say, terminal. You don't know the oil's coming out, fluid's coming out, or anything else. You know, you need to get off that track.
I'm not entirely surprised that the incident involving Dan Hellyer, Jesse James, Jones, and number two, Tom Oliver, at Chris Curve is under investigation.
That isn't a surprise, is it? It was a fairly harsh move by the two of them.
It was a bit of a gang-up, wasn't it? And there's some lovely, besides the gentleman that you interviewed, Jed, there's some great characters out in this. You know, there's a 6'6" postman called Gary B. He knows as Big Gaz, riding number 88. He's down in 21st place. He has to have elbow scrapers because he can't help but get his elbows down. He's even taller than Connor Cummins, he told me proudly.
All right.
A few places behind him in 24th place is a quiet Scot, 17-year-old Scotsman called Russell Brown. And he's come down from just south of Glasgow on the train with his mum and then met his dad here with the gubbins necessary to go racing. So there's some entertaining and unlikely characters out in this competition. It's a good one. Chrissy Rouse leads it. He's one of the entertaining and unlikely ones. And then in second place, that battle between Charlie King. This is Suffolk versus Spain. And then Freddie Pett and Phil Atkinson.
I was going to say that when Charlie King, the man on the yellow bike there, front of that group, got to the front of the group and got a bit of clear space going forward to the race leader Rouse, if he could put anything like the times he did yesterday, he could actually have caught Rouse, but it's Rouse that's responded, just sticking the fastest lap of this racing.
So 133.109, very, very close to making himself a sub 133 second man on that lap, and that more positions paid work dropping down. This is the battle for seventh place involving Jesse James Jones, Luke Shelley, Scott Pitchers, Ben Miller, Sam Middlemass, Sam Cox, they're all in there. Don't be deceived by the Kawasaki green. They're all on Triumph 6. The move made into the chicane. That one was quickly responded to.
That was kind of the end of the same move, that, Jack.
It was, yes. So, number 89, Shelley, has got back in front of number 111 Pitchers, I think. Chrissy Rouse at the front.
Tied a little rider, Chrissy Rouse.
Just going to say he's got a lovely start.
He has,
hasn't he?
Yeah.
And he's, you know, he's smiling, happy lad. He's enjoying life, enjoying doing his A-levels.
And that's it, 32.8. I think that would be a new lap record, I think.
It would indeed. 132.872, a new lap record. As number 71, Kieran Newman, enters the pits. There's the new lap record confirmed for Chrissy Rouse, who's really on the gas now on the eighth of 10 laps.
And that's the race leader passing Murray Ambrose.
And as he flings it right through that right hander, you see from that high position what a long, almost double apex curve Chris Curve is, James.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
An odd kind of structure. The wonderful thing about this circuit is that there aren't any kind of consistent radii bends at all.
No, it's a very natural circuit. There's nothing that feels like when you ride it. It's been laid out on a kind of drawing board. That's a Spanish rider.
Oh, and he grabbed it back well from that moment, didn't he? I thought that Freddie Pett would have him then.
Yeah, it just doesn't feel like it's been laid out on a drawing board with a protractor, you know. It's not. A lot of the modern circuits, and I won't mention them, mostly abroad, I have to say, are just. Here we go again. This is Alista's moment. Out. Ooh, there you go. Gets the throttle squeezed open, coming out of Mansfield, and lets the back lets go.
Jesse James Jones has retired to the pit, so. I suppose. He was going to be under investigation anyway, so he's probably thought, oh, what the heck, I'll pull out now.
Yeah, he talked about Cadwell. A lot of the modern circuits feel like they've just been had the most corners squeezed into the smallest amount of real estate they could buy, with all the corners, constant radius of varying radiuses. This, you've got a bit of everything camber and radius-wise. This feels always felt like to me like you've got one of them big tarmac lane machines and set a drunk man away on it and just see where he came back.
And here's the result.
Yeah.
Well, don't forget, back in 1926, Mansfield Wilkinson bought this land for hunting and shooting, really. But his son, Charlie Wilkinson, was a little more modern in his ambition, and he formed the Louthan District Motorcycle Club and persuaded his dad to let him run the first meeting in 1934.
And I can just remember Charlie Wilkinson being here on my early days of racing and watching in the late 70s, early 80s.
Yeah, he used to run this place single-handed.
Correct. He took the money going in, and he served sandwiches, and he never let go of the reins in Charlie.
I mean, set it all in motion in 1934. Phenomenal. Ninth lap out of 10 then, and Chrissy Rouse in the lead. Number 76 there, Charlie King second. 91, Alex Alucia has been somehow, despite his moments, persistently fending off number 66, Freddie Benton. That man, number 3, Philip Atkinson, the South African on the Qingdao WK bikes, and Pure Triumph 675. And behind them, Tom Oliver, Luke Shelley, Scott Pitchers, Sam Middlemass and Ben Miller rounding out the top 10. Gary Beale, he scrapes his elbows because he's such an astonishingly tall.
Like dogs don't post. We've had a sticker on our door a couple of times.
And Gary Beasley, the 25-year-old from Chesterfield, then the colossally tall postman, now almost on the edge of the points. Chrissy Rouse leads it. Charlie King still holding Reid in second place, and then we're looking back through the mid-pack. You can see there's a fair few scraps still going on. We're on the final lap, and there's still one or two positions to be decided yet. Breaking into Park Corner. One thing I was really impressed by when I popped outside to watch these guys rolling into pit lane before the race, James, that high quality of turnout of the bikes. There's beautiful fairing designs and colours and finishes.
Yeah, and that's pretty much constant throughout all classes at British Championship. BSB now, there's a lot of well-turned out bikes. Really is.
So flat stick along the base there of the mountain and then flick it left and drive up that steep face. There's Chrissy Rouse. He is on his way to victory yet again in this class, which would make it, I could have told you if I hadn't lost the sheet, his eighth win of the season. Chrissy Rouse then, the Geordie boy, does it once again for the Stratstone Racing Team. He takes the double win here at Cadwell Park, increases in lead in the championship. Charlie King takes a brilliant second place. Alex Alicia hangs on for another podium finish. The Spaniard nicking it from Freddie Pett and Philip Atkinson. Tom Oliver crosses the line in sixth place. Now ahead of Luke Shelley, who does get the better of Scott Pitchers, and then that battle behind them involving Sam Middlemass. Cox gets the better of Miller and just pushes him out of the top 10 in the run into the line in front of Tom Haywood and Tyrone Skinner gets the better of Haywood in their last lap battle, but a great ride by Chrissy Rouse. He is proving the dominator of this championship this year. Chrissy Rouse takes it for Stratton Racing Triumph. Ooh. Oh, we've got a faller.
Yeah, that's just before the hairpin. Just on the last lap, there was a few riders together. There might be more than one involved, I think. There is two bikes involved.
This is one.
He's got to be in the back.
Oh, dear. That was a bit violent.
And I heard James Hayden say it earlier, but there used to be absolutely no runoff there about 3 or 4 years ago. That would have been not so good.
Fortunately, he was able to, obviously, adrenaline flowing and fury rising.
He was able to leap
to his feet and gesticulate with the offender. So, Chrissy Rouse from Emmanuel College, Gateshead, studying A-level maths with mechanics, physics and economics, has done a really economical job here. He's started from the front row, he's set a new lap record, and he's won it for Stratstone Racing to take his eighth victory of the season in the glorious sunny setting of the Lincolnshire Wolds. Chrissy Rouse in first place. Charlie King, an excellent second. Alex Alicia in third. Freddie Pett fourth ahead of Philip Atkinson. Tom Oliver, well, still under a little investigation, in sixth. Scott Pitchers, Luke Shelley, Sam Middlemass and Sam Cox. And behind them, the rest of the point scorers, Ben Miller, Tyrone Skinner, Tom Haywood, Dan Fuller and Gary Beasley, the 6 foot 6 inch plus postman, makes it into the top 15 from way back in 24th, 25th place. Great ride by him ahead of Taylor, Wood, Corbino, Burditt and Little. The championship standings will make comfortable reading for Chrissy Rouse in the Triumph Triple Challenge. A two-thirds season's distance. He has 151 points, the only man in three figures. Freddie Pett is second on 93. Charlie King leaps up to third on 91.5. Just a 0.5 of a point ahead of Alicia and Atkinson. And Dan Hellier is in sixth ahead of Scott Pitchers in seventh. Tom Oliver moves eighth ahead of Jesse James Jones, who pulled out of that race. Sam Cox in 10th. 11th place, Dan Fuller ahead of Luke Shelley and Tom Haywood. Middlemass in 14th place, Corbino 15th. And the rest of the top 20, Taylor Little, Alistair Fagan, Ben Miller and Piers Hutchins. This is how the race unfolded. A little sluggish start there for the man on pole position. Great start for the man from the second row, Alex Alicia of Spain. He swoops through to grab the initial advantage from Chrissy Rouse on the pace. Charlie King's yellow pressure Integrity Racing Triumph in third place. As they spread out, coming out of Charlie's and head down the laughingly named Park Straight. Here we go, 33 riders. And at the front, Alicia making initially a bit of ground. Then that move, driving down into the gooseneck. Great move by Chrissy Rouse, forces the gap that he needed to take the lead from the Spaniard, who starts to come under pressure from Suffolk's very own Charlie King. And then we have a fall as Dan Hellyer gets forced out, really, by Tom Oliver and Jesse James-Jones, left with absolutely nowhere to go. The former second-place finisher goes out. Chrissy Rouse, though, is really in control of this race, looking very, very comfortable as he just pops down through the dappled sunshine, through to Barn, via the hairpin and Hall Bends, and swoops out onto the start and finish straight. Great ride by the Geordie boy. He takes victory. Charlie King in second place. Alash Alicia just hangs on to third ahead of Freddie Pett and South Africa's Philip Atkinson.
Well, we're here with Alex Alicia. We were just talking before you came to us then about a big problem. Let's see you, Alex, and it's the dreaded arm pump at Cadwell Park.
Yeah, I suffered arm pump since the fifth lap, and I'm just struggling to follow Chrissy. But then Charlie passed me and I tried to follow him with the same problem all again, but very happy to be at the podium. Not expected because this is the most British circuit track. So very happy to be up here.
And what do you think to this most British circuit?
It's very fun to ride and the jam is crazy.
Really, you like it?
Yeah, I love it very much.
Excellent, we like watching you race. Very well done.
Thank you very much.
We'll let you go to the podium. Well done, Alex. Alex Alicia there. Our third place finisher. Our second place man was Charlie King. Well, listen, in terms of the overall championship, you're now elevated above Alex. It's just half a point, but hey, half a point's half a point.
Oh, yeah. After the start yesterday we had, it was a bit of a nightmare. I was chasing Chrissy and I wanted to win so bad. And unfortunately, just pushing a bit too hard, I lost it and caused another crash there. But it's a points consolidation today. I lost half a finger basically yesterday. The top half of my finger, it's just so painful. I've physically done that then. I just can't believe how we managed to pull through.
Park, it's not an easy day, is it?
No, it's just the pain I was riding through then for both my knees, everything. I can't believe what I've just done there. I'm physically shattered and I just can't believe we've managed to pull through. Really...
Well, what you need is a nice rest with maybe a bit of champagne to cool down in this heat. We'll let you go to the podium. Well done.
Thank you, Tony. So everyone's helped this year, appreciate it.
Nicely done, Charlie. Charlie King there, our second place finisher. Let's listen to our race winner then, Chrissy Rouse. Well, listen, 151 points overall now. You've got a big lead over Freddie. Freddie's on 93, eighth win of the season, double win here. It doesn't get much better, does it?
Yeah, it's been going really well recently. Apart from when I ran out of fuel at Snetterden and we finished every race in the podium, and eight wins so far, so couldn't really be asked for much more. And I hope it keeps going through to Donington and have a good finish to the season.
It certainly looks like it could go that way for you. But talk about Cadwell Park here. What have been the main things you've had to overcome this weekend?
Just the fierce competition, really. I mean, me and Charlie had a fantastic battle yesterday. I'm credit to him for just even getting out and riding in that race. I seen a picture of his finger this morning. It's absolutely disgusting. Like, he was telling us about in the med centre that they chopped a chunk out of his finger and just like a chunk of flesh. Like, I'm absolutely amazed he's been able to get out there and race. And I was watching my pit board and he wasn't going slow. He was, I'd say, 76. Just push on and control the race, and just delighted to take another win.
Chrissy, it's a delight to see you developing as a racer. A delight to see you on the podium. We'll let you go there now. Well done.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
Nicely done. So, Chrissy Rouse will now go up to the podium. Time for Jack then to take us through all the champagne spraying proceedings.
That was a very nice touch there, Chrissy Rouse, remembering the late Ben Gawtry. Of this season. A kid who started riding bikes when he was seven, that was 10 years ago, with a Malaguti, and he raced motocross actually for a couple of years on a Suzuki RM65 till it was nicked together with all his gear, and that was when he was prompted to try road racing Metrokit 70, and he entered the Fab Racing Metrokit British Championship and gradually got a little more confident and faster doing that. And he eventually moved up the British 125 GP Championship, initially with SGR Racing, then with the vastly experienced former champion Steve Patrickson. And learned. He said he learned a huge amount that year, managed a few top 10 finishes, a best result of sixth. And then he entered the Triumph Young Guns in 2011 and was chosen as one of the 10 finalists, and it's been all onwards and upwards since then. Second place for Charlie King. That's a remarkable performance for he's really, for him to get out there at all after that accident yesterday was quite something. He'd set the lap record, of course, pressing so hard before he fell. That lap record has now been eclipsed by this young man, Chrissy Rouse. Charlie King, of course, is on top of the rostrum for the Cup competitors. A good ride by him. He's tell you what, the hand's still working quite well. He managed to get the cork out of the champagne. I mean, heck. Right, you've got to come back out now, Charlie, and do it all again. Guy Masters of Triumph is presenting the trophies to the boys. Charlie King will be back out there in a moment alongside the third-placed Spaniard. It's good to hear one of our continental visitors enjoying a quintessentially English circuit like this and speaking of and praising Cadwell Park. But Alex Alicia obviously enjoyed that. He fought really hard for that third place because he came under a lot of pressure from Freddie Pett, but fended it off, made a couple of mistakes along the way and recovered from them, and hung on to that third place. Second place then to Charlie King on the Pressure Integrity Racing bike. And then Stratstone Racing's very own 17-year-old, two 17-year-olds there on their first and second places. Very impressive. Chrissy Rouse, delighted with that race win. A young man who names Cadwell Park alongside Brands Hatch and Oulton Park as his favourite circuits. And his favourite riders, Valentino Rossi and a certain Barry Sheen. It's great. I love it when a kid knows a bit about his history and he appreciates someone like Barry Sheen, who was at the top of his game rather a long time before a lad like Chrissy Rouse was born. So the champagne gets sprayed then by Alex Alicia, and Charlie King struggles this time, not surprisingly, and suffers at the hands of Chrissy Rouse. His eighth win of the season then, and the championship looking ever closer for Chrissy Rouse at two-thirds distance.
Well, there we go then. What a great result there for Chrissy Rouse in the Triumph Triple Challenge. Eighth win of the season for him out there. Really good performance from a man who's looking likely to be the champion, it has to be said. Nobody can hold a light to him. 151 points he has. Freddie Pett, the next best, on 93. Right, we're going to leave the Triumph Triple Challenge alone right now. We're off for a short break. When we come back, it's time for the Screaming 600s. The Motor Points British Supersport Championship race is next.
The GB Grand Prix awaits the remarkable Marc Marquez. But can our own Cal Crutchlow claim victory on home soil?
Cal Crutchlow, what a lap from the brick!
And another brilliant podium!
MotoGP Silverstone races Sunday from 10:35 a.m. on British Eurosport HD.
Messi?
Hey, kid.
Kobe Bryant? Would you like to have some ice cream, young man?
Ice cream.
Cheers.
With Europe's best airline, Turkish Airlines.
Our super fast engineers are ready to help you make the switch. And you can keep your current broadband until ours is installed. So you're never without the internet.
DVDs, memory cards. We want to store life. But before storing memories, first, you need to live. Renault Captcha. Capture life. and introducing the all-new Renault range, featuring the Captur crossover, the 100% electric Zoe, and the new Clio. Book your test drive today.
It's all too easy. You see a gap, and it's there for the taking. Wind on the throttle and you're through. Traffic? What traffic? But can you react to something you can't even see? No chance. Don't get the door closed on you. Bikers, it's not a game. Filter with care.
WeBuyAnyBike.com sponsoring British Superbikes on British Eurosport.
Well, welcome back to Cadwell Park. World Superbike on the way next weekend to tell you about. It's round 10 of the championship from Nürburgring. Saturday, 4 o'clock, we'll bring you all the Super Pole action on British Eurosport 2 HD. Stay with the channel for our live race action. 9:15 Sunday morning. It's a bit of an early start, but the Nürburgring usually throws up some good racing. So we will see you there for that. Well, here at Cadwell Park, the Parc Fermé area and the pit lane area is very busy, as you can imagine. So we've just grabbed Pete Exton, the team boss of Quattro Plank Kawasaki, the man who basically has the auspicious job of looking after Chris Walker out there. And Chris is riding superbly well this season, Pete, and we wanted to talk to you about that because he is arguably having the best season he's had for maybe 5 years. What do you put that down to?
Well, quite a few things, really. I mean, Chris is obviously one of the most well-known guys out there, such a professional guy. Chris almost looks after himself to an extent, as much as my job is to keep Chris's morale up and things like that. But the team we've got around him, with Ray Stringer, who's been with Chris two or three years, he understands what Chris wants to do. And we've always said that Chris, a happy Chris Walker, goes, and he's very, very much used to the Kawasaki, and he's almost been on it since the start. And I just think Chris is really strong, and he's in a happy, confident place. And once you get him into that rhythm, there's no real stopping him. You know, it's going to be a struggle to move him much, much more forward into a showdown position. But you know, Chris is riding phenomenal, and you know, everybody's got to, you know, the guys that are chasing him, the Westies, etc. They're very fast, young, fit riders, and they're struggling to keep up.
Yeah, absolutely. You talk about the possibility of getting into the showdown. It's not out of the realms of possibility that such a thing could happen, of course. And a lot of the credit has to be put down to the team as well, because without a good team around him, Chris and Ray couldn't do very much.
No, absolutely. And, you know, they've built it up over the last few years. I mean, I'm obviously there to own the team and run the team. And, you know, it's quite an easy job with Chris, because he'll come in, he knows exactly how he wants the bike. He's a finicky guy, and, you know, Chris knows whether it wants one click here, one compression there. I think he's probably a pleasure to work with, because the crew chief and the rider understand each other so well.
The Kawasaki. Talk to us about the Kawasaki. What is that like as a machine to set up, and what sort of level of help are you getting from Kawasaki, if indeed any at all?
Well, we are the official Kawasaki UK team this year, which obviously we're very, very grateful for. And I have to contribute some of that to Chris as well, because Chris's results last year have helped us move into the realms of being the Kawasaki team. We don't get too much help from the World Superbike team, but again, it's a different championship. It's a different setup of the bike. So we get obviously some backup with parts and things like that, and it's great to be part of the Kawasaki family. I myself have a Kawasaki dealership, so that all goes hand in hand, and it just works really, really well. And certainly we're happy with the Kawasaki manufacturer for sure.
Let's focus on Cadwell Park and the unique problems that brings to a race team. How's this weekend gone so far for you?
The weekend's gone really, really well. We've got a new rider this year as well. Over the last two rounds, Barry Bowler has been brought on board. Barry's been going quicker and quicker all weekend, and we're looking for Barry to score some points and for Chris to be up around the showdown area. What the problems that it brings, issue with coming backwards and forwards across the circuit and things like that. But I think as long as you set up correctly at the beginning, again, we've got an experienced crew. They know what to have down here, what to not have down here. And as long as the weather's reasonably kind, which it obviously is today, it's phenomenal, then it will be smoothly.
And from a business point of view, from a team owner's point of view, and from a dealership point of view, what does it mean to you to see such a massive crowd here and such support for British Superbikes?
Well, it's quite phenomenal, really, and I'm sure everybody is aware that, you know, there is a downturn in motorcycle sales, especially super sport bikes. And when you come here, you have to almost wonder why. You look around, and it's just incredible. I'm not sure what the attendance figure is, but the sun's shining, people are eating ice creams, are enjoying themselves, and you've got to say that British Superbikes is you know, surviving and working phenomenally well. It really is a superb event, and hopefully the guys and girls out there can relate to the motorcycles that they see, and that's why we've got to be strong for Kawasaki and show that the Kawasaki ZX10 is a premier machine.
Well, I think you're doing that superbly well every weekend. Pete, we'll let you go. Thanks very much for talking to us. Do appreciate it, and best of luck in the next race.
Thank you very much.
There you go, Pete Eckstein, Bournemouth Kawasaki, the man who looks after the Quattro Plant Kawasaki. He has Chris Walker, and then, as you said, Barry Ball, the new signing there. Look forward to plenty more from them in the second race. James Whittam's just stepped in to join me again as we take a look towards the British Supersport Championship race. Jim, that is coming up next. We've had one race this weekend already. Of course, we have the sprint race and the feature race. The sprint race was really all about Ben Wilson's performance, but also about a crash. Alistair Seely off the bike, the championship leader.
Alistair Seely went down Mansfield, not injured at all, but yeah, had big implications for the championship. Really good to see.
This is the crash. This is Seely going down there.
And
he went down quick, didn't he?
That's a fair crash. It's not very often you see a bike end up on the inside of the circuit. But yeah, Ben Wilson rode well. We've seen him ride well here before. Loves the place. I think it suits his kind of aggressive, get-stuck-in kind of riding style. But Stuart Easton came from having a nightmare through free training and through qualifying. His bike exploded and he didn't get out. He did just about four or five laps before he had to go and qualify. He was learning all the way. And unfortunately for Stuart Easton, there was another crash that brought the red flag out just before the last lap started.
Yes.
And he'd already just about got in the lead and would have won it had he gone full distance, I think. So unfortunate for him, but I think he's not too disappointed.
To Stuart Easton now, because Whit did catch up with him after the race yesterday. Here's what Stuart had to say about what's happened at Cadwell Park so far.
Stuart, considering he had about four laps in before he went into qualifying and was disappointed not to have more track time and felt on the back foot, that wasn't bad, was it?
No, we'll take that, especially with Seely having a bit of a misfortune, and we get 20 points, so it's helped the championship. But just a little bit disappointed with getting into lead, and then the red flags came out just when I got into lead and got counted back a lap, so I ended up second, but that's racing.
Yeah. We were watching that and we thought you were going to have a nip at it.
No, I was feeling good as the laps went on. Like you said, I never had much lap time here. We never tested here, and we missed Friday with a technical, so straight into qualifying this morning, and then led the race, so happy enough.
Didn't seem to make a lot of difference, well done.
Cheers.
Let's go. There is an air of confidence about Stuart Easton that I like, but he sort of dresses it up in the whole, we're missing this, we're missing that, missing that, you know, but he has to believe in himself when he goes on track.
He's just such a nice kid, isn't he? He just never...
We still call him a kid.
I know, he is about... He just looks like your paper boy. But he's a nice bloke. Never kind of overstates what he's done. He tells you what the facts are. And it was a good ride. He said he was going to be learning the first part of the race. It's a funny place, he said, because there's so much involved and you need to be kind of brave and have the bike set up so you can push on a little bit and feel comfortable and safe. It's difficult to come here, even if you've been really quick the time before, to go straight back on it. You need that kind of build-up time through free training and through qualifying, and he's just missed that. And I think the first part of the race was him just settling in.
Sure. Well, it's interesting that you said that about the build-up time, because the race winner yesterday was Ben Wilson. He had plenty of build-up time here. This is his local track, and then some. Here's what Ben Wilson had to say.
Well, to be fair, Ben, you said you were going to do that 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, it was. You know, we got the result. You know, they went back a lot, but at the end, obviously, because of the red flag. But you know, we'll take a win however we've got to take it. You know, we led all the race, felt comfortable. You know, just started to lose a little bit of grip towards the end. But we've got to work on that for tomorrow. But yeah, we got 25 points, and that's all we're here to get.
What is it about this place that you love? Because you always seem to know the business here.
I don't know. I just like jumping.
Well done, mate.
Cheers, mate. Thank you.
But also psychologically.
Yeah, psychologically more than anything else, I think. Because we just started to see authority and not become unbeatable. That it's never happens in bike racing, that, but just look to be the man most weekends. And we saw what happened. He fell off a bit of a, you know, small mistake, but it ended up in quite a big crash at Mansfield there. And yeah, he takes on a whole sort of new light to the championship now. If he can one more mistake and they're right back on him. And puts a bit more pressure on Tyler Cecilia, gives everybody else a little bit more hope, the Easton and especially Ben Wilson, who started to just get a bit frustrated with his teammates kind of putting one over him every weekend,
yeah,
you know?
Didn't he just? Well, I'll tell you what, the lads are forming up on the grid behind us. James Hayden is over there, ready to do his grid walk. So, James, Witt and I are going to throw it to you.
Well, there's some days when you just think, like, oh, I'd love to be out there. The crowd like this, the sunshine, Cadwell Park, absolutely fantastic. But listen, we're back on the third row of the grid, and we're going to speak to Richard Cooper. Richard, always good to see you. How's it going out there?
Yeah, it's always fantastic. It's the race at Cadwell Park. You know, I secured my first ever British Super Sport podium this time last year, and, you know, we're pretty much in the same position I'm on the grid at the moment, so we're not a million miles away. We seem to be off that back of that leading pack, and I'm waiting for them boys to make a mistake at the moment, and the way they ride, I'm pretty sure it won't be far away, and we'll be there to pick up the...
Do you think it's just a matter of getting off the start a little bit better, getting away with them?
Yeah, I mean, yesterday was the first two laps was an absolute nightmare. I ran an SC0 and I had no confidence, and once the pace came in with the tyre, it was as quick as the leaders, you know, but it was a little bit too much too late type thing, so we need to get away. Ben Wilson in front, you know, there's no better starter on the grid. Follow him through, I think we'll be fine.
Excellent. Okay, well, best of luck, Richard. Okay, now listen, we're going to go through to Ben Wilson. Ben Wilson grabbed his third win of the year yesterday, looked really, really strong, and he is so strong just out the gate. He just really concentrates on getting that start and trying to get away. Ben, you've had 10 podiums, you grabbed another win yesterday. Obviously, you'll be going for the double.
We'll just see how the race pans out. You know, hopefully we've got a good setup, and we'll just keep it flat out and just, you know, see how the race goes and just try and be there at the end.
You look so strong off the start. What's the secret?
My dad teaching me when I was about 5.
Wicked. Okay, best of luck, Ben. He's concentrating there. Let's also grab a word with Graham Gowland. Graham got his first podium for Colin Appleyard team yesterday. Got to be happy with that.
Yeah, no, I'm over the moon. You know, it's great for the Appleyard MacAdam team. We really needed it, and yeah, hopefully it's the first of more to come. Hopefully get a good start here and see what happens.
Cool. What's this? Get well soon, Emma.
Emma's just had an operation last week, so yeah, we wish her all the best and hope she gets better soon.
Okay, excellent stuff there. All right, thanks, Graham. All right, we're also going to grab a word with Jason O'Halloran. Jason, he just runs back. Was it quick loo trip?
Yeah, a bit nervous today, mate. Arm race and all.
How's it going out there anyway yesterday? I mean, have you made any changes?
Yeah, we've had a few changes this morning in warm-up. You know, small changes. We're looking for tenths of a second, you know. Unfortunately, I had a bit of a mistake on lap one yesterday and I dropped right back and I lost too much time on the first two laps. So today we're going to be pushing from the start. Go with the group. It's anyone's race.
Is it suspension changes you made mostly?
Yeah, just chassis changes. Trying to get the bike to turn a little bit better, you know. We're struggling with turning this weekend. Front feeling, but we think it's coming from the rear, so she changed the rear shock for this one and hopefully it works.
So it's a bit of a gamble there.
Bit of a gamble. We like a gamble.
All right, good luck. Okay, Jason there. So now we're going to go through to the guys on the front row, and you can see now the big news yesterday was Alistair Seeley, obviously the championship leader. He'd been one of only two people to finish every single race this year, but yesterday crashed out whilst battling for, you know, for the win. So Alistair Seeley on pole there, and he, remember, he's had 13 podiums, 6 wins. He's been really, really strong. But we'll grab a word with him. Let me come in this side. We'll grab a word first. Alistair, you've been one of the most consistent men, you know, all season. So, but a little slip off, you allowed one of those. Yeah. What happened?
We were struggling sort of from two laps in with a rear grip and just got caught out in Mansfield trying to bet Eager, and rear just came round. But it was too far around and snapped back the other way and slammed me onto the ground. So a bit second hand today, but just get on with it, really.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, is the body okay?
I just grazed elbow, grazed hip, sore ribs, sore neck, the usual.
No, it didn't seem it really. I mean, for the amount it stepped back, it really seemed to ping back, didn't it? Yeah. Have you seen it?
Somebody had it on Facebook last night, so I had a quick look at it, but just try and forget about it and get on with this race. Yeah. You know, try and come away with some points today.
Yeah, but you still got a fine championship lead, so you must be feeling confident.
Yeah, it was nice to have that buffer, you know, if anything happens. So it has happened. Hopefully there's no more of it. And try and get some points on the board and move away to the last 4 rounds, which are probably more my stronger circuits.
Okay, well, best of luck, Alistair. Okay, we'll have a word with the man in second spot. Stuart, you finished second yesterday, second in the championship. Big bonus for you, though, him crashing out yesterday.
Yeah, 20 points is gained on the championship, so it's a good day for us. Should have really won it, but the red flag came out a wee bit early for us, so that's racing.
Make amends today then?
I hope so. I think you can never tell how it's going to go. It's track temperature's fairly high. And the bike felt quite good yesterday, so we'll see.
And basically from yesterday to today, I mean, have you ridden in this temperature over the weekend?
I've done very few laps, to be honest. I did 16 dry laps before the race yesterday because I had a problem on Saturday, so I've done very few laps, but yesterday went okay, so that's all we're going by.
Okay, well, best of luck, Stuart. Okay, we're going to move across now. We're going to move to the pole man, Billy McConnell, always serious. Billy, on pole, fourth yesterday, but you were, you know, kicking all the way on for a possible podium. Yeah. How are you feeling for today?
Yeah, nervous as always. You know, it's a big crowd, and CAD was one of my favourite tracks, so the triumph really works good for me at the end of the race, you know, so it's a shame yesterday we did all the work to get there and try for a last lap dash again, but...
Well, it works better when you use tyres?
Yeah, the tyre just gets a little bit more wear and I can just start to steer it on the rear a little bit better. You know, it starts to point in the right direction as I wanted to go. So, but, you know, the all-new bike, it's getting better and better each week. So, you know, I want to give it its first win and I want it to be today and now.
All right, OK. Well, listen, we better let you get ready because everyone is getting packed up. As you can see here as well, it's an absolutely massive grid. You know, this Supersport race has also generally been one of the absolute classics. Cadwell Park, the jump, 50,000 people. A grid full of absolutely superb riders on great machinery. I can't wait. Tony, it's back to you.
Thank you very much, James. Yes, well, you can see 5 minutes to race start. The car is off to do its track inspection before the boys are headed out on their warm-up lap. We're going to take a short break as the grid is cleared. We'll be back with all the action from the Motorpoint British Supersport Championship race. See you back here at Cadwell Park in two.
The same, except this one's 12p cheaper. Free insurance and £1,000 off the deposit. What do you think?
Yeah.
Oh, kitchen roll.
To William Hill on your mobile. Hill, the home of betting.
In a world of myths and gods.
In a world of myths.
Gods. Glorious warriors and their allies advance into battle to expand their powerful empire and take command of Grepolis with their alliance. Choose your god and build your empire. Now free at grepolis.tv.
We Buy Any Bike, sponsoring British Superbikes on British Eurosport.
Well, welcome back to Cadwell Park. Some breaking news to tell you about. You'll remember you've seen this crash here between Simon Andrews and Tristan Palmer. Watch the and bike, that's Tristan Palmer being knocked wide by Simon Andrews. That happened in the Superstock 1000 race. Well, we've just heard that Simon Andrews has been excluded from his third place finish. So Simon Andrews excluded from the result. That moves Victor Cox up into third. So some would say that's the right justice for that move. But we will move on now and concentrate on the Triumph Triple Challenge. And I'm sorry.